Well, good morning, everyone. This is Nina Olson, and I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Taxpayer Rights. And we are very pleased to open our first workshop on Reimagining Tax Administration Social Programs Through the Tax Code. This program is funded by the Rockefeller Foundation, and although the views of the speakers do not reflect the views of the Rockefeller Foundation or the Center for Taxpayer Rights for that matter, everyone is really thrilled to have an opportunity to have this workshop series. Today's program workshop is really the start, the foundation for considering running social programs through the tax code, which is to understand the actual underpinnings of IRS return processing programs like the Earned Income Credit, the Child Tax Credit, the current Advanced Child Tax Credit, and proposals going forward, all imagine, well, and the Affordable Care Act with the Premium Tax Credit and Advanced Premium Tax Credit and other programs all involve return processing and claims on returns. And so we thought it would be a very good starting point to so that everyone could have a baseline understanding of how returns are actually processed by the IRS and some of the specific requirements that the IRS faces and some of the limitations given its legacy systems and architecture that might be a little different from some of the traditional social safety net programs that folks are used to interacting with. Because as you may know, you know, the IRS processes over 150 million individual tax returns and millions of other returns that come in through businesses and information returns. So we are really fortunate today to be joined by a really great group of people from the IRS who are up to their elbows in the issues of return processing, identity theft, and then getting refunds out. And we're joined by Ishmael Alejo, who is the Assistant Director of the IRS Return Integrity and Compliance Services Unit in the Wage and Investment Operating Division. Denise Davis, who is the Director of the IRS Return Integrity Program Management. And we'll spend a lot of time about what that word return and those words return integrity mean. And then Rob King, who is Assistant Director of IRS Web Applications Program Management Office in IRS Information Technology. So I think I'm going to turn it over. I will be monitoring the question and answer. What we tried to do is we'll have presentations by the speakers. Rob has to leave us a little early, so we'll do some Q's and A's with him first. But there will be, you know, time for folks to ask questions, and I'll also be monitoring the chat. So if you want to put questions in there, I will, you know, and then I can insert them in, you know, as things go along, but we'll also open it up, you know, toward the end. We have 2 hours to open it up toward the end for questions and answers. There are a few caveats here. You know, I know that there is proposed legislation, you know, a markup out there for Ways and Means. The folks from the IRS are not going to be able to speak about any legislation that's pending and under consideration. So be understanding of that. Thank you so much. And let's go forward. I think Denise, you are actually the person who's going to be talking next. And Denise is staying despite the fact that she's kind of lost her voice.
Well, good morning, everyone. What we're going to do, if you want to go to the next slide, Nina. Okay, so the first thing we're going to talk about is who typically files a tax return. And we'll talk about some of the recent legislation associated with the pandemic that has impacted our new filing and how taxpayers or citizens receive various benefits of the economic impact payment and advanced child tax credit. We'll talk a little bit about how returns are filed and introduce you to the language and the process of that process. And then we'll talk a little bit about the IRS challenges. You know, obviously with filing refunds, and various benefits, there's the risk of both identity theft and refund fraud. And then we'll talk about the processing of those activities, as well as some additional information regarding identity theft filtering and non-identity theft filters, which is the return integrity part to help prevent the IRS from improperly paying thieves or even some civil fraud. So you want to turn the page? Okay, so here is what everything looked like for a 2020 return. This is without the legislation. You can see that it is based on filing status. This is single, someone that is filing a return as a single person without dependents, married filing jointly, taxpayers that are married, they may or may not have children, married filing separate, that they're married and they have opted to have the primary spouse file a return separate from the typical secondary taxpayer. Also head of household, a single person that is supporting dependent children and qualifying widower. These are all, you know, based on a set of criteria. Things change and the thresholds for filing are different depending on the age and then also income. And so this is the typical matrix that you would see when you go to file a return and whether or not you're required to file a return. And this is the normal construct that we have. And these are the normal prior to the pandemic response that we would receive about 150 million tax returns, generally meeting this criteria a year. So that is how we start, is where the income is. Now, the latest legislation, and there's been a series of them, starting in March of 2020 with the CARES Act. And then there was another piece of legislation in late December of 2020 related to the economic impact payment. And then a third, which is probably much more expansive, and that is the American Rescue Plan Act in March of 2021. So generally, let's talk about the language. Economic impact payment. There have been three rounds of economic impact payment, and those were authorized to pay in advance of a specific credit on a return. And that's called the rebate, the recovery rebate credit. So what the IRS is doing is that we'll pick the third one, since this is the one that last one that was paid. The IRS is paying an economic impact payment starting in March of 2021 as an advance to a recovery rebate credit that would be claimed on the 2021 return. This series of economic impact payments sometimes require a taxpayer to participate in the tax system where they might not have been required to. They didn't meet the criteria before. Some examples are people that are homeless, people that are generally underserved and don't have the income requirements to file a return. It may even require people that are in the prison systems that are entitled to these benefits. So you also have the recovery rebate credit. That is the process where the actual claim for the recovery rebate credit is what we call reconciled on the return. So the taxpayer may have received an economic impact payment as part of the relief for pandemic. That particular payment is reconciled with the facts and circumstances with their return. If they are due more credit, they will get additional recovery rebate credits on that return. If a taxpayer missed out or believe they missed out on an economic impact payment, they can still file a return and claim the recovery rebate credit and receive the full amount that they are entitled to. Then there's the advanced child tax credit. This is where the IRS is going to pay 50% of the estimated amount of the child tax credit that would be claimed on the 2021 return. So those payments are new. They just started in July. We've paid August, and now starting tomorrow and on Wednesday, the IRS will start releasing the third round of advanced child tax credit. So generally, these are payments that are these payments are equivalent to about $3,000 for a child over six, $3,600 for a child under six, and the taxpayer would receive these benefits, 50% of it, and it would be prorated over in this case for 2021, since we started the payments in July. The 50% would be prorated over the 6 months payment cycle for those particular credits. For the economic impact payments, the law uniquely provided collaboration between the Social Security Administration, the Veterans Administration, as well as the Railroad Retirement Board. Many of these beneficiaries may not have filing requirements. So instead of having these beneficiaries have to file a return, that may be one, confusing, two, may not even meet the normal threshold for filing. The IRS took the effort to collaborate with these agencies to identify these beneficiaries that have not filed a return and made those economic impact payments to the bank accounts or debit cards that are associated with those benefit payments. So let's say, for example, a Social Security recipient, I'm just making up a scenario, Social Security recipient, 85 years old, has not filed a return in 30 years. Only income is Social Security, does not have a filing requirement, but does get their Social Security benefits on a direct express card. The IRS made those payments on behalf of that taxpayer to that direct express card. So that is what the legislation provided us, those unique relationships to both collect information for these citizens in a desperate need for these pandemic-related benefits. And we did that without having them interact with the IRS. So I'll pause for a minute. Nina, do you have any questions or comments on the generalities of an economic impact payment, recovery rebate credit, advanced child tax credit, and our collaboration with other governmental agencies?
Yeah, thanks, Denise. There was one question that came in just for clarification, because just when the term legal non-filer, that basically means someone that's below the filing threshold, correct? As opposed to a non-filer who has an obligation to file and has not done so.
That is correct. We can talk about that a little bit more when we talk about filtering,
right.
And we'll get a little bit further down the filing process, and I'll tell you what we're looking for and why some taxpayers that are taking advantage of these tools may be what we call rejected, meaning we aren't able to accept their electronic filing.
That's great.
Does that help? Okay.
Yep, that's great. Thank you. So do you want me to go to the next slide?
Yes, that'd be great. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit about what got introduced. I just want to let you know this is very simplified. Every taxpayer will need to consider their facts and circumstances. So what these payments for the Economic Impact Payment 1, Economic Impact Payment 2 and 3, Advanced Child Tax Credit. generally for the economic impact payments is that they have to meet income limits. Generally, it starts phasing out for higher income taxpayers. The phase out is slightly different between the various economic impact payments. But in this case, for this particular panel, I'm assuming that these are the underserved taxpayers and are not the higher income taxpayers that may be part of phase out. The economic impact payment is available to U.S. citizens, a U.S. resident alien, and that not claimed as dependent by another taxpayers. Just at the bottom of the chart, you can kind of see the money that's involved. For the first economic impact payment, it was $1,200 for a single, $2,400 for a joint taxpayer, those are married taxpayers. And then it would be $500 for each qualifying child reported on the return. The second round of economic impact payment is $600 for single, $1,200 for a joint filer, and $600 per qualifying child. And then the third impact payment, well, let me tell you, economic impact payment one and economic impact payment two were advanced credits to a 2020 tax return. For economic impact payment three, it's an advance payment for a 2021 recovery rebate credit. So for economic impact payment three, it's $1,400 for single, $2,800 for a joint, with $1,400 for each qualifying child. In order to calculate these economic impact payments, generally, dependent on the payment, we were able to use filed returns from a prior year, 2019 or 2020 returns. We calculate the credit and we can send those payments to the taxpayer. The IRS actually does a lot of work with the Bureau of Fiscal Service and to further convenience taxpayers that we may deposit those monies to a bank account known to the government. This goes back to our example with Social Security Administration beneficiary, Veterans Benefit Administration, and there may be other payments that may be made by the government, by the Bureau of Fiscal Service, and those bank accounts are shared with the IRS so we can electronically deposit those monies. The reason why direct deposit is so important is one, if you go back to March of 2020, the pandemic, many banks were closed. So electronic payments were very helpful. So taxpayers did not have to cash those checks directly with the bank. They could get access to those monies on their own account. And we still continue to look at the convenience and not have taxpayers have to interact more than necessary with the financial institutions. All right, so moving on to the advanced child tax credit. This is a little bit different. This is an advance of an advanced child tax credit that is expanded for 2021. Today, we're calculating those payments. We started those payments in July, and it's based on a filed 2019 or 2020 return. It's based on information that was actually filed on a traditional tax return. And we'll talk a little bit more about this, about what we call a non-filer tool. A non-filer tool is a very simplified tax return where taxpayers provide minimal information that we need in order to calculate and determine the advanced child tax credit. And we'll go into more of those tools in a little bit. Again, these taxpayers lived in the main home for more than half the year in the 50 states and District of Columbia. They have a qualifying child who's under 18 and has a valid Social Security number, and also made less than certain income limits. I mentioned this before, this is an advanced credit. The credit for a child under five and under at the end of 2021 is equivalent to $3,600. And since we're paying 6 months, or half that over 6 months, $1,800 of it would be advanced. Then for those children that are 6 to 17 at the end of 2021, will be eligible for a $3,000 credit with $1,500 advanced. Nina, you have any questions or anything?
I think a couple of people wanted to make the point, for example, that when we refer to someone as a U.S. resident alien, for purposes of the tax code, that means something different than just having a simple green card. You know, the immigration status under the immigration laws of the United States are different from the tax laws. A U.S. resident alien can, for tax purposes, can be somebody that has a green card or that has that meets the substantial presence test, which is a formula based on the number of days that you're actually present in the IRS in the United States over a period of time. And if you are a U.S. resident alien, then you're taxable on your worldwide income, regardless of where it's earned, subject to treaty provisions. And then there are certain provisions where, you know, a resident of Canada or Mexico can participate in some benefits. But I don't think we need to go into that, just really raise the issue. So let's go. I really want us to get to this slide, which is the how, you know, getting started into the nuts and bolts of how the returns are actually filed. So thanks.
Okay. All right. So there are a couple of different venues in which a return is filed. The most traditional is an electronic file, and those are usually software-based. Those returns are submitted by practitioners. It may be do-it-yourself from software. It could also include other outreach programs, such as the volunteer income tax assistance, low-income tax clinics, the Free File Alliance. So there's a lot of different venues for e-file. And then, of course, some taxpayers either can't electronically file or opt to file a paper tax return. So what are some examples other than preference to file a paper return? Some taxpayers may have a condition on the return, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, that their return is rejected from electronic filing. The reason why a return could be rejected, most common in this particular scenario, is that a return has already been filed, or the dependent has been claimed by another taxpayer. Those are some of the more common scenarios in the population associated with economic impact payment, recovery rebate, and advanced child tax credit. What we introduced starting last year is that we had a non-filer portal. And this goes to what Nina was talking about. As taxpayers that do not have a traditional filing requirement, however, that they want to provide the IRS information. They want to provide information that they are interested in the economic impact payment. This is starting last year, so it was for the economic impact payment. They provided us minimal information, and they provided a bank account number if they had one, where we can electronically deposit that economic impact payment to. For the advanced child tax credit, the non-filer signup tool has been launched, where it is now collecting, is still a streamlined return, but it is collecting more information associated with qualifying children on that return in order for the IRS to consider about the eligibility for those qualifying children and the taxpayer and provide enough information for us to determine any advanced child tax care credits. I'll pause for just a second. If Rob or Ish, do you want to go into more detail on the non-filer sign-up tool and how that's being used?
Hi, Denise. This is Ishmael, or Ish Alejo. And so as she mentioned, and as she laid out at the beginning, the non-filer sign-up tool is a streamlined return. So in particular, with the advanced child tax credit, when ARPA was passed and signed, there were provisions where our starting point to estimate the tax year 21 annual amount of the child tax credit is based on information that IRS as an agency is aware of. And the way we get information is through the filing of these returns, whether streamlined or your, I guess you want to call traditional or full-on return. So we have the non-filer sign-up tool that was created, and you can find that on the CTC page, but there are also other methods highlighted in this slide where a taxpayer who normally does not have a filing obligation can set up their convey the information necessary so we can estimate their tax year 21 annual amount, and then from that start advancing the child tax credit for on a monthly basis between July to December.
So Ish, is the if you go through the non-filer, the use the streamlined tax return via the non-filer sign-up tool or through these other tools, that is a tax return, correct?
Yes, from the IRS perspective, it is viewed as in our system, one as a tax return. We pick up the elements of it, there are, but we call it streamlined because there are certain elements that in your normal software, like if you're filling out, are not present, but that's because those are things that we don't need to estimate the child tax credit for the tax year 21.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, so you can imagine, unfortunately, a lot of our underserved taxpayers that can be, you know, those that are homeless or even the elderly taxpayers that do not have traditional filing requirements or have always been at risk of identity theft. Now you also have these provisions that allow for the economic impact payment, the recovery rebate credit, and the advanced child tax credit that may incentivize some fraudsters to come forward and attempt to claim these benefits on behalf of a vulnerable taxpayer. So, you know, that is the underlying issue that's been going on for years regarding identity theft is, you know, the fraudsters try to get enough information about a taxpayer to file false returns. And an unsuspecting taxpayer wouldn't even know until now that they might be a victim of identity theft. So what is identity theft? For the purpose of tax refund fraud, it specifically occurs when an individual uses another person's taxpayer identification number or social security number to file a fraudulent tax return to obtain fraudulent tax refunds. And so many of these individuals of this type of victim may not even be unaware. Like I gave you the example earlier about a taxpayer, the Social Security recipient, 85 years old, that has any knowledge of interacting with the IRS for 30 years. However, an ID theft may have been interacting with the IRS, you know, trying to get various benefits. It may not be the EIP, may not be the RRC, but it may have been about withholding credits or other refundable credits, and they've been victimized. So what we have having to do, as we've always done, is that we filter our filings for a couple of different things. One, when a taxpayer, whether they file e-file or file on a paper return or file a streamlined return, we do check for filing requirements to make sure that if a taxpayer is interacting with the IRS through the non-filer sign-up tools, which is supposed to be streamlined, that they do not actually have a filing requirement and should be filing a typical full return, a full and complete return. Now, why do taxpayers or good taxpayers get mixed up into this? With the economic impact payment one, there were a lot of taxpayers that were desperate for those payments. And some taxpayers went into the non-filer sign-up tool and filed returns. And they were typically filers that may have balance dues and may have returns that are on extension to file in October. So some taxpayers got confused and they did file returns through a streamlined process that they should not have done so. We also have fraudsters that are potentially trying to do the same thing. And the IRS is looking to protect both. One, those taxpayers accidentally using the non-filer sign-up tool inappropriately, as well as to keep fraudsters from trying to get ahead of our underserved communities and file those returns. I'll pause for a minute because that's actually a pretty heavy, we'll talk more about the process if they get contacted by our identity theft process, which is called the Taxpayer Protection Program. But Nina, do you want to add anything before we talk about some of the non-identity theft screening?
So I do have a question. If someone tried to I don't know whether you'll know this or not. If someone tried to file a streamlined return and it turned out that they had sole proprietorship income, self-employment income, and although it might be under the filing threshold, but they also have to file a Schedule SE reporting their own Social Security tax, basically, would that be caught in the streamlined return process and be rejected, or would you catch that later on when you were matching, you know, 1099s and stuff like that?
That is somewhat complicated, Nina, okay, because it depends on what information the IRS has.
Right.
Because some taxpayers are totally cash basis. The IRS may not have the 1099 non-employee compensation in our possession during the screening process. So it is, my answer to that, it's complicated.
Okay. But if you did have the 1099, would that be something that you would reject, or would you pick it up, you know, in the screening process, or would you pick it up later? Let's just take
this. This would be picked up if it was selected for potential identity theft.
Okay.
This is, the return has already been accepted into the filing system. And what we are doing is we're not allowing that return to quote post, meaning we want an authentication process to occur before we allow the return to complete its processing journey and the refund paid.
So that's, we've now entered some new terms, which I think are really important. And I know we'll talk about later, but we've said, you know, the return is accepted for processing, but it's now, but it's blocked from being posted, which would mean it would move on and ultimately a refund order would be issued. Is that correct?
Yeah. And the next slide, we can walk through what that journey looks like.
Do we want to do that next, or what?
You ready? Well, why don't we go ahead and do that? Because I can cover the non-identity theft screening a little bit later.
Okie doke.
Okay. All right. So
For background for a second, these little excerpts are from a roadmap that the Taxpayer Advocates first produced in 2019. We'll be very happy about this. I loved this project. And I will share with everyone a link to the full roadmap because it really is a helpful and scary thing to see, to get an understanding of the IRS process. Sorry.
I knew you would love this, Nina. That's why we use this. It may also be called the subway stops. Okay, so basically, this is the filing process for preparation. And the first thing for normal taxpayers is that they receive and gather their specific tax information. This is includes, you know, getting a W-2 statement. It may include, like Nina was talking about, information regarding self-employment that may may involve a 1099 miscellaneous or 1099 for non-employee compensation, interest statements, dividends. They're gathering all this information to prepare their tax return. If the taxpayer along the way has questions about the filing of their return, there are various resources available. IRS.gov, and I don't want you to forget that, most of this information is actually that we're presenting you today is on IRS.gov. There's also toll-free assistance. I'm on the bottom track, Nina. IRS tax law assistance is somewhat limited. Most of it's self-service. There is a plethora of IRS forms and publications. And then, of course, there's the IRS Taxpayer Assistance Center. And if the taxpayer chooses to interact with the tax return preparer, and I'm going to use that return preparer loosely because it may be a VITA assistance, low-income tax clinic. It may be anyone that's providing assistance to that taxpayer. And then, of course, this tax software itself. Industry has developed a lot of software. They have, dependent on the software, has a lot of interview style questions prompting the taxpayer. Depending on how they answer questions, is the types of forms and schedules that are prompted for the taxpayer to complete. Some software actually integrates and will actually electronically consume the W-2 information, et cetera, and place on the tax return. Why is all of this prep so important? Because the preparation really can have an impact on the actual tax return process. We'll talk about that on the next slide. So what the ask from the IRS is that a taxpayer file a complete and accurate return. And so that means it considers all of the information, their income, and their family situation. So the next stop going down, can the taxpayer file the return by the deadline? There are taxpayers that may not be able to file by the deadline. They may have complicated tax returns. They may be self-employed. There might be a lot of other work that has to be done, such as, evaluating their expenses and gathering their receipts, or even have complicated issues, such as there might be investments in other organizations, such as depending on a Schedule K-1 or other form types that might not be readily available on April 15th. So these taxpayers are able to file an extension through October 15th. Now, for 2020 and 2021, due to the pandemic situation, there were some automatic extensions to file that were granted along the way because of the pandemic situation and because some taxpayers may not have been able to get into a tax practitioner if that was their choice. By April 15th. So But I just want to just clarify that the IRS is amenable to extension requests. However, the IRS does ask that the taxpayer provide an estimate of their tax obligation when they file their extension request if they have a balance due.
Denise, I want to stop there for a second just to make sure. Rob, I think you said that you needed to leave early. I'm not sure. I can't remember the timing on that. Are you okay?
Yes.
Or we maybe switch to you for a bit to talk about security and data.
Yeah, I have to leave at 11:30 a.m. So yeah.
All right. So you're good. Okay.
Sorry about that.
Okay. So now that you have decided whether you're going to file an extension or go ahead and file a return, taxpayer can use the software, the free file. Can you go back? I'm sorry, Nina. Okay, so when they file electronically, it does go through some checks at filing. One of the biggest, the most relevant to the economic impact payment and the advanced child tax credit is when these electronic file returns come in, especially from taxpayers that have not been engaged in the tax system, the number one and number two reject condition, meaning there is something already on that return that we know there's a problem. And that is usually one of two scenarios. A duplicate filing condition, meaning a tax return has already been filed by that taxpayer, or the taxpayer may be attempting to claim a dependent that has been claimed by somebody else. I know that those are sometimes very complicated civil issues, but there are some taxpayers, that the child may be move between the parents and grandparents and other care providers, and they may be claimed on a return. That is an example of a duplicate claim for dependency. Now, where a duplicate filing condition goes into play is that some taxpayers, and I mentioned this a little bit before, some of it's confusion, where a taxpayer tries to file a non-filer sign-up tool return just to get benefits because they might have filed a return that has not completed process, and it indicates as a duplicate filing condition. And the IRS cannot have two electronic file returns from the same taxpayer. So what happens in a duplicate filing condition? Unfortunately, that taxpayer will have to file a paper tax return for the IRS to be processed, transcribed, the whole nine yards here at the IRS. If the taxpayer believes the duplicate filing condition is associated with identity theft, the taxpayer can provide a unique statement on that return, a Form 14039 identity theft affidavit. And then that return, when it's processed, will be treated special because there we have a taxpayer making a claim for identity theft. So this is the pre-filing activity, what happens in the most common reasons for a reject associated with economic impact payment and the additional child tax credit. So Nina, if you don't have any questions, we can go to the next slide.
There was a question, and I guess we can also get to this later. They were asking, we discussed identity theft, and then there are the non-identity theft issues as well, relating to overstated income, overstated withholding credits, things like that. And there was a question about, how many of these kinds of reject codes are there in the system, and a question about what percentage of the ones initially stopped ultimately end up being held. rather than being resolved and passed through. I know that's a big issue, and if you want to talk about it later, that's fine, but that was a question that came in.
Well, that's a problem. It's actually a perfect question, but it's conflating multiple things.
Right.
Okay, so a reject condition is something on that return. It's not anything associated with other third-party information, such as the W-2 or the reporting of wages and withholding. Those are, like I said, the most common are, is that Social Security number has been used as a primary, secondary taxpayer on the filing of another return. That taxpayer may be claimed as a dependent on another return, or the dependents on that return have been claimed by another taxpayer. There are many reject conditions. I'm looking it up real quick. There's an estimate of about 1,500 reasons why a return will be rejected. Some of them are very rare. I'm giving you the most common scenarios. The next phase of the return, which gets into what we call our non-identity theft filters, is where the electronic return has been accepted by the IRS, but the IRS has other third-party information or is missing third-party information, and we have to hold that return and look at that return for a little longer period of time. There's a couple of reasons. The first speed bump happens around February 15th, where the IRS, according to the PATH Act, Protecting Americans from Tax Hikes of 2015, we are required by law to hold all tax returns until February 15th that claim the earned income credit or the additional child tax credit. We hold those. The purpose of the hold is for us to verify the income on those returns. The majority of those returns, even though they're held on February 15th, the law, the PATH Act, actually accelerated the due dates for the W-2 and Form 1099 miscellaneous to be January 15th versus the common due date before the law of March the 31st. So the IRS actually amasses and collects all of these information returns, and we reconcile to make sure that taxpayers the original purpose was for the proper claims of earned income tax credit and the additional child tax credit by April 15th. Over time, the first year we did this was in 2016, and we've been doing this for 5 years. Majority of the taxpayers that are filing complete and accurate return, their refunds are released on February 15th with no issues. They get their refund as soon as possible based on IRS processes, as shortly after April 15th as possible. We do a lot of preparation for this refund hold. There's a lot of communications in advance associated with this refund hold where we'll tell the dates, and usually they're paid in two releases, and the taxpayer will know what to expect. The financial industry is also prepped for this mass movement of these refunds just after April 15th. I highly recommend, if this is something that you're very concerned about, for the PATH Act refund hold, follow the IRS communications on the Get Ready campaign. Also, information is associated once a return is received and processed by the IRS, the taxpayer will be given an estimated refund date through Where's My Refund. I know that's not on the slide, but the taxpayer can always be checking it. There will be populations of taxpayers that report income and overstate withholding that cannot be verified by the IRS. Some of it is associated fraud, where the taxpayer made up the W-2, made up the income, made up the withholding, and that employer does not even exist to file the W-2. There's also pockets of, you know, maybe the employer may have been non-compliant and may not have timely provided their W-2 information to the IRS for this particular process. For taxpayers that are impacted by non-compliant employers, meaning those tax employers that refuse to timely provide the information, we take that into account, that if a taxpayer or if an employer has a history of non-compliance, we will take that into consideration and release those refunds for the taxpayer. Generally, the IRS does receive a lot of this information, usually by around June 15th. But in the meantime, the taxpayer is notified that we are continuing to review their income and withholding. Taxpayers can interact with IRS and provide, you know, copies of their paycheck stubs or similar for us to evaluate whether or not we have an issue with the reporting of a tax return, where they might have added an extra zero to their withholding. Instead of withholding of 1,000, they might have put in a withholding of 10,000. They might be able to clarify that. We can make the adjustment and move forward with the return.
So, Denise, just to go through that just a little bit, so people have a good understanding, and to also give your voice a rest. my understanding, first of all, is that the return is held. You have screens. I know that you can't talk about this in great detail, but you've processes to check whether the taxpayer has been compliant in the past if you don't have the W-2 information from the employer yet in the system. And that may result in the return, the taxpayer's return being released because they've been compliant over a series of years, I think. You also said that it was possible, you know, the taxpayer is going to get a notice. The taxpayer has an opportunity to call the IRS. Now, we all know that the IRS has been having, you know, unprecedented call volume. So these are all things that may make it difficult for the taxpayer, but this is how we're describing how the system's supposed to run and why it's running the way it is. There's a way to, you know, to correct things that are easy, or provide copies of W-2s and things like that, right?
Correct. And if a taxpayer, when they realize they were reviewing the return, and then they go back and review the return and they realize that they made a mistake, the taxpayer can file an amended return and we can make those adjustments and then release any refunds that they are entitled to at that point.
However, all of this, as you said, you know, you usually get most of the information about W-2s or employer validations, you know, in June. So during this time, the taxpayer's return is held and a refund will not be issued. Is that correct?
That is correct. If it had not been for the pandemic, prior to the pandemic, I probably had 95% of all of my W-2s by the end of March. So you're talking, you know, the majority of the information the IRS has, the majority of the information the IRS is able to consume. And it's that problematic group of 5%. Is it fraud, or is it employer compliance, or is it a mistake? Does that make sense?
Yeah. And I also think it's really important to note, first of all, that the W-2 information you're getting is coming from Social Security. And years ago, you know, it took a while to get the information over. Now, as I understand it, you're getting information from Social Security on the W-2s daily. Is that correct?
That is correct. You know, despite, as the word you used, legacy systems, we do turn our systems to be daily processing for the consumption of W-2s. We start receiving those W-2s at the very beginning of January, and we continue to receive them all year. But we do not use our weekly processes. We consume them daily. We release refunds daily. So we've done a lot over the time to make that experience as positive as possible if we have the information.
Okay. And I think the other thing is, I recall from my days in the IRS, you know, that in terms of employer identity theft, in the sense of identity thieves actually generating fake W-2s in order to receive, you know, refunds from entities, they were getting very clever and realizing that you were checking with the W-2 information. So you're even seeing employers filing, you know, identity thieves filing with Social Security so that there would be fake information in there to work through, to match against.
To your point, the sophistication of both identity theft and some of our non-identity theft is more and more sophisticated. It might be predicated on data breaches, phishing, manufactured information. The good news is, especially in non-identity theft, since you've left, Nina, is that we've had legislation to help increase the electronic submission of these W-2s, where we're not dependent on the Social Security Administration to transcribe. We'll be looking forward to the benefits of that. So in the past, an employer that had 250 or more employees had to file electronic. And so that left a big gap for small companies to not file electronic. And so now that threshold under the Taxpayer First Act is steadily dropping. The first drop will be to 100 or more employees must file electronic. And then in 2 years, it will be 10 or more will file electronic. And that provides that information to the IRS in our screening processes much sooner.
That's great. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so we want to go there. Here we go to the process. Okay, so here the return is. I'm gonna follow the track up at the top for refund claims. So after the return is accepted, meaning there's no apparent reject condition, there's no other return on file for the taxpayer, dependents haven't been used by something else, so now we've got a refund return. So the next step that the IRS does is look for indicators of identity theft. We have over 250 rules and sub-rules in place looking for identity theft. We also are able to look at the historical filing pattern of the taxpayer. We also look, whether or not the taxpayer has been a victim of identity theft in the past, and is this return vulnerable? Has an identity theft protection PIN been used? So we take all of these factors into account when we do our identity theft. And the majority of the returns, the identity theft filters will be passed. And to give you an example, I just looked it up this morning. It's less than 2% of the taxpayers that get caught up by our taxpayer protection program. So we'll go down the path that, that yes, the identity theft's verified. We'll talk a little bit more about what happens if we stop. The return also goes through other reviews. There may be errors found on the return. Some of those are mathematical computational errors. But if there are no errors on the return, the return will continue its journey and process. And what they use the word post, meaning that the return is good, the return is posted, and then the IRS will consider releasing those refunds. So that's when the return posts, and the majority of those returns will follow that path. Now, specific to the pandemic legislation, the IRS has always checked for mathematical errors. Most of those errors are, you know, missing or inaccurate information, or mathematical computations. The pandemic legislation, especially with the recovery rebate credit, a lot of taxpayers misunderstood the amount of the the economic impact payments. So let's say, for example, the scenario of what this math error looks like. The taxpayer received economic impact payment one for $1,200. Taxpayer received economic impact payment two for $600. That's $1,800 of economic impact payment. However, when the taxpayer reported on the rebate recovery credit, they didn't capture both payments. They only reported one. They only remembered getting the $600 payment because they got that payment just before the tax return was due. So now the IRS thinks there's a problem. We say that you got paid $1,800 and you're saying you got $600 and you want the other $1,200. That becomes what we call a math error. And the IRS will issue notice to the taxpayers stating that there was an inconsistency on the return. The taxpayer in a math error situation has 60 days to provide the IRS other information if they want us to consider for the math error. If the IRS takes no action and they realize, oh, darn, I forgot about the $1,200 payment I got in April, and the IRS is right, the IRS will process the return, make the adjustment, and we all move forward. If the taxpayer protests that particular math error, the IRS will stop and take a look and see, you know, what are the other issues that are particularly driving that math error. Was the taxpayer, let's say, a victim of identity theft, or was the payment returned to the IRS in some way? That there will be an investigation to evaluate whether the IRS is going to agree with the taxpayer or agree with the information on our systems. And that's pretty loaded. So, Nina.
Yeah, math error is huge. A few points about math error. Math error can only, this authority is, it's what's actually called summary assessment authority, which means that the IRS can make the change and then the taxpayer can object to the change, but the change is already made on the IRS systems. And if the taxpayer comes in and disagrees, then the IRS has to back that out and then look at it more closely and then go through the normal procedures of what it would do to adjust a return or add additional tax. And the math error authority can, summary assessment authority can only be used if Congress explicitly statutorily authorizes it. So there's a long list of things by which it's authorized. And as Denise pointed out, you know, Congress added the authority for the IRS to use math error authority in the context of errors in reporting economic impact payments when you're including your rebate recovery credit. So it's actually part of the return processing rather than being done after the return has been actually processed and posted. And it's very important for taxpayers to pay attention to these notices. We have a whole different thing about how clear the notices are, but it's very important. And if they disagree, then to come in that 60-day period, sometimes they can get it fixed by simply a phone call. You know, I switched the digits on my child's social security number when I typed in their number. That's one of the reasons why where the IRS might actually disallow a child for purposes of the earned income credit. The IRS gets data from the Social Security Administration based on the child's name and their social security number. And if there's a mismatch with that, Congress has authorized the IRS to disallow earned income credit and other provisions relating to that child because the child's name and the child's social security number based on that social security information don't match. And then, you know, you won't get a lot of money, a lot of credits, these very important social benefits that are run through the code with respect to children, if that happens. So very early in return processing, you may have to interact with the IRS because of, you know, a missing digit or a switch digit or something like that.
Thanks, Nina. Okay, so that's math error. But there are other processes that may require what we call a more compliance-oriented treatment, and this is done in a pre-refund environment. So for example, as we move down the right-hand trail, the return may be reviewed for other questionable items. One of those questionable items might be overstated withholding, overstated wages. There also might be some other business rules associated with the specific of the refundable credits, such as a pre-refund exam on refundable credits. If a taxpayer is identified for what we call treatment, compliance treatment, the taxpayer was receiving notice, a proposed adjustment. This is why we are making this change that, for example, the wages and withholding were not verified by the IRS. They appear to be questionable. It could even be something simple like the taxpayer may be claiming a rebate recovery credit on a return, and they're not authorized by law, such as they're not a U.S. citizen and they do not have a Social Security number associated or valid for work purposes, as an example. IRS will send notice, and then depending on the scenario of the case, if it is going through what we call the automated questionable credit program, a taxpayer will receive a certified statutory notice of deficiency, and that will give the taxpayer the opportunity to petition tax court or agree with the notice. And we will accept, although we do not ask for it, if there's any kind of information they want us to consider at that point, we will. But that is the AQC process. There's another one listed on here called wages and withholding, where that is, we just disallow the overstated withholding. And instead of issuing a notice of deficiency, we issue a notice of claim disallowance, meaning we'll allow all of the refund except for the overstated withholding amount. And then that amount is included in a claim for notice of disallowance. And that does provide some taxpayers not the ability to appeal in tax court, but can appeal that decision. And that is the two mechanisms in which we make those adjustments in the processes in our return integrity process.
So we had a couple questions, and I want to stop for clarification and then maybe turn it over to Rob for a minute just to talk about data processing, and then we can come back. I wanted the folks on the program, the attendees, to recognize that Denise has really talked about two very important things. She's talked about the automated questionable credits, and that as a result of that process, when you get a letter saying, you know, we have concerns, you will get a notice of deficiency. And what that notice of deficiency is it gives the taxpayer notice that the IRS is proposing to make an adjustment to the return, and the taxpayer has 90 days within which to file a petition in the United States Tax Court. And why that is so important is that the United States Tax Court is the only forum, the judicial forum, where a taxpayer can petition a court before the tax is assessed and due. And any other time the tax has already been assessed and the taxpayer could be be dealing with IRS collection while the taxpayer is trying to actually get the right answer. So this 90-day notice, this notice of deficiency, is incredibly important, because if the taxpayer one comes into the IRS within those 90 days, maybe it can get the taxpayer can get the matter fixed during that period. Sometimes that's hard. Again, you have to get through on the phone, et cetera. Also, if the taxpayer, but if not, then the taxpayer could petition the tax court. The tax court has dockets where they are very taxpayer friendly. There is a petition form on the tax court's website, all those sorts of things. And the vast majority of taxpayers before the United States Tax Court are pro se, or what we call self-represented. They do not have representation. The notice of disallowance, on the other hand, claim disallowance, which you get if your wages or your withholding are being adjusted, basically says the IRS has the authority by law to make that adjustment and notify you that we are not, that the IRS is not allowing you these, all of these, you know, withholdings that you claimed, because we have information that they're not accurate, and we're adjusting it down, you know, we, the IRS, meaning they, the IRS, and then we're sending you this notice, and you can then make a refund claim saying, IRS, you're wrong. These were the correct amounts, but the adjustment has already been made. And to get to court, you would have to pay the tax first and file in federal district court, not the tax court. So you can see how important the tax court notice of deficiency is, and then some instances where you won't have the opportunity to go to tax court. I think at this point, I want to go to Rob because he's got to leave, and then we can come back to some of these issues. But you're beginning to see, I think, just how complex the system is built, you know, and it's built around the fact that, you know, the IRS gets so much information that either has errors on returns or has, you know, has identity theft or other, you know, fraudulent type activities, some of which are perpetrated by preparers themselves. So let me move forward to Rob to talk a little bit about the child update portal, and then also talk a little bit about why we have all this security and things like that.
Thank you, Nina, and hello, everyone. You know, because I only have 15 minutes left, I think Denise did a good job summarizing, you know, the child tax credit update portal. And, you know, once again, legislation was passed that were, you know, mandated the IRS to provide payments, advanced child tax credit payments to, you know, those who claim the child tax credit, who, you know, who are in need. And one of the American Rescue Plan requirements was for us to create an online tool that would provide taxpayers the ability to, you know, opt out of receiving the payments, also allow them to, you know, update the number of children they have, if they've had a change in, you know, marital status or income, things that are kind of central around the, what would be central around their 2021 tax return to help influence the amount of, you know, how much they would receive, be eligible to receive in child tax credit. But, and as you can see, there are some numbers below in terms of, you know, this was created. I won't go into those numbers. You can see those. If we can go to the next slide, I'll talk about what it takes to get, you know, from legislation to full implementation, you know, and getting a system, you know, developed. But so translating right there, we have kind of the legislation, infrastructure, security, data, design, accessibility, documentation. Those are general steps in what it takes to really, you know, get an application from concept to delivering into production. And, you know, starting at legislation, you know, challenges of, it's challenging to, you know, interpret what legal language is into something that can be changed into software. It takes lots of coordination with, you know, legal. It also takes coordination with what's called PGLD within the government, and it stands for privacy, governmental liaison and disclosure. And, you know, it's PGLD's job to protect sensitive, you know, information of taxpayers, make sure their privacy is, you know, taken into consideration, and making sure that when a web application is created, only authorized information is, you know, disclosed. And so those are, it takes, you know, communicating with the right people to make sure, as we're about to translate this language into business requirements, to make sure everything that's being communicated to the IT team is accurate, and there's not a risk of potential disclosure. One other part of planning is we need to make sure we communicate, you know, there's communication and liaison. I know that's not under legislation, but that's still another part of it. After it's kind of translated, you need to make sure that we work with the communication and liaison team just to, and it's their mission to, you know, build relationships and understanding between the IRS and other stakeholders through effective information sharing. So we just need to kind of let the, you know, public know, hey, this application is about to be built. We want to let everyone know this is what you can expect for a child tax credit when, you know, when the child tax credit application is implemented. So another part, infrastructure, you know, securing servers, development environments. For the child tax credit portal, the IRS was actually able to leverage all existing infrastructure, but that's not always the case. And to be honest, there's a lot of lead time when planning, you know, the development of a system. And, but for this particular effort, the IRS is actually very lucky, and we're able to kind of use infrastructure that was already in place. Security. And this is definitely something that I want to talk extensively about where it's a very much a most critical part of what we do. We've got to plan for security when it comes to delivery. You know, NIST, or the National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST doesn't protect the data, but they put guidelines that federal agencies like the IRS have to follow to protect personal taxpayer data. And, you know, before I get into some of the ways that we, you know, have to protect it, I want everyone to know protecting taxpayer data is not optional. It's the law. Things we're talking, social security numbers, you know, personal information, investments, bank accounts, other sources of information, other sources of income, and more. And I'm going to go on a limb. I'm pretty sure that, you know, all of us on the Zoom and those who are not here, we don't want that information shared with others. So what do we do to protect it? And as in this case, where we built the Child Tax Credit Update portal, we can start with online access. And IRS.gov has grown significantly to provide taxpayers with their own information. And this portal here was, you know, another example of providing taxpayers with their information needed when it relates to child tax credit. And to meet the NIST guidelines, the IRS is now working with what's called a credential service provider, or CSP. You may hear the acronym CSP. It's called ID.me. And many users of the Child Tax Credit Update portal use ID.me for authentication. And eventually, all users of IRS systems will be required to use and authenticate through a CSP in order to access, you know, all of the online services and applications. But ID.me's job is to go through an authentication process, you know, for each person who logs in and, you know, validate that they are who they say they are. And you know, they offer multiple, you know, options to provide, you know, for evidence, driver's license, passport, state identifications, you know, phone verification, just many things to help with identity proofing. They also offer kind of the multi-factor authentication options where, you know, how we, you somehow, you, maybe you log into your Google account and, or your Facebook account and bank account, where you have them send you a text message and you provide the code back to them just to verify that you are that truly that individual. So the CSPs offer multiple ways to validate data and, you know, even outside of using a CSP, the IRS does additional forms of validation to truly verify once again that, you know, Scott Smith is truly Scott Smith and that we're only going to share the allowable information with Scott. So those are the many steps that are taken to protect taxpayer data. And so going on from security down to data, we have here where the IRS has many legacy systems and, you know, storing new data. And so when Denise was talking about, you know, how when returns come in and, you know, they're actually analyzed for fraud, you know, and to make sure the fraud's not there, after going through all of those checks and the return eventually being accepted, this is where the return is stored in what's called, what the IRS is called, master file. And this has always been our source of legacy data. But as a result of, in 2019, the IRS released a multi-year modernization plan. And that was to move to many initiatives, move them to modern solutions to help improve the taxpayer experience and, you know, strengthen cybersecurity posture and better work with the tax community. And so when designing the child tax credit upgrade portal, many of the data, most of the data that's been in legacy systems has been moved to modernized systems. And that is the data that was used for child tax credit update portal. And also Get My Payment, you know, when stimulus payments were released last year, there was a Get My Payment application that was created, but it's very promising to see that these, both of these efforts used data from a modernized source. And, you know, until 2020, when the pandemic took place, data for online applications was strictly used from legacy systems. So, you know, now that we're having the taxpayer data, you know, used from modern sources, it's, like I said, once again, very promising. It very much is helping us meet the mission of the mod plan.
A question, yeah, about that. So yes, when in a legacy system, that may mean that the data is not the most up to date because the legacy systems are on different cycles, but these new data systems might be more up to date, which would go to, like, if you were doing your Get My Payment, you'd have more updated information. Is that correct?
To a degree. Okay. For instance, when, as a result of Child Tax Credit Update Portal, if a user chooses to opt out, well, opting out is not something that legacy systems retain. If a user chooses to change the number of dependents that they have, or choose to change their adjusted gross income, this is not information that our legacy systems withhold. So But however, our modern systems do retain this information. So yes, Nina, to your point, yeah, this is an example of information that is not stored on our legacy systems, but it is stored on our modernized systems.
And do assisters have access to that data? Like if you call up, they will be able to see that data?
Yes, yes. And yeah, part of what the effort when, you know, implementing solutions like this, we know everyone does not have access online, you know, to, and maybe use a web browser, mobile phone, you know, to access online systems. Part of what the IRS is doing is making sure this information is also available to customer service representatives should anyone, you know, have need to call and choose to opt out over the phone or make an update inquiry or whatever it may be via the phone as well.
Thank you.
Sure. You know, going also to design, this is one of the, you know, key. It's very key. You know, and as an early programmer, you know, I used to just think you can just put something on a screen and people will understand how to make it work. But I'm sure as we, you know, have all looked at, you know, looked at our Google, looked at our Facebook, and you see many of the many ways on many screens that you can do many things, whether it's sending a text messaging or sharing something, making a payment. That same consistency is what we're looking to achieve with the user experience for all IRS, you know, external facing applications. And it's very important. It makes a really big difference for, you know, the taxpayer experience so that it's not disjointed. And it helps also to determine what the future needs would be as well. And on to accessibility. Accessibility, once again, this is legal. This is not just a nice to have. This is to make sure that if we're designing a web application, this system is available for those who need screen readers. And that, you know, this, if you're tabbing from one field to another, the user knows exactly what they need to do. And there's no, you know, difference in use or no difference in use whatsoever. So this is part of what it takes to truly plan and develop, you know, what an application requires. And last, documentation. We truly have to document and audit all requirements, you know, all of the data that we, you know, are using and so forth. Have you looked into, I was gonna say, Nina, unfortunately, it is my time right now. I'm being pinged.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for doing that. I think what we'll do is Jim Pugh had written about, you know, human-centered design practices, and we actually have a whole workshop with folks who have been very much working on human-centered design and one of our workshop series, and also on administrative burdens. So stay tuned for that. I think, Denise, first of all, Rob, thank you so much for that.
Thank you.
And Denise, maybe we can come back to you to talk about something that I wanted people to be sure to understand, which is the issuance of a refund. You know, we went through this whole process and you get to the assessment and then the return posts. And then if all is good, a refund order is generated. And so who issues the actual refund payment and where do offsets come in?
Okay, all right. How is a refund issued by the IRS? So what the IRS will do is to position the account for a refund. And then the IRS, if there's other taxes due, the IRS may offset those taxes that are due within the IRS. But the actual payment of a refund is actually a process that we engage with the Bureau of Fiscal Service. meaning we provide a file to the Bureau of Fiscal Service to go ahead and execute a refund payment. Typically, a refund is released by the IRS and has a payout date of about 4 business days from the day the IRS released the payment to the Bureau of Fiscal Service. So what happens at the Bureau of Fiscal Service? The Bureau of Fiscal Service may look for other federal debt a taxpayer may owe, maybe legally due to the government. It could be student loans, child support, and the Bureau of Fiscal Service will offset those payments for those other government, and the net, if there is a net, will be paid to the taxpayer. Now, what is very different for the IRS for the advanced child tax credit is that the settlement date is within 1 day and the payment date is set in advance. So today, when an IRS issues a refund, it goes to the Bureau of Fiscal Service. It gets processed, and it can be processed any day of the week, but generally the payout, the settlement date, is 4 business days. But with the advanced child tax credit, we declare in advance that the payment is going to be, in this case, September the 15th. That file will be processed by the Bureau of Fiscal Service on the 14th, and those payments are available to the taxpayer on the 15th. Very different paradigm than for a normal tax refund that could be paid any day. And the settlement process, settlement means the date the IRS authorizes the payment to be made and when it is scheduled to be available to the taxpayer. And of course, you have to add time if a paper check is being issued. Is that what you're looking for, Nina?
Yeah, and I think also then once the IRS has you've achieved the settlement date, it still means that Bureau of Fiscal Service is going to look at offsets by other programs. You know, the refund, the IRS may offset the debt against a past, the refund against a past tax debt. But when it gets to Bureau of Fiscal Services under the Internal Revenue Code, you know, it will look at under the Treasury Offset Program, it will look at whether the refund would be offset against child support arrears, student loan, state tax debts. And those, the IRS has no role to play in that. It's at that point, it's out of the IRS's hands. And the taxpayer, unfortunately, has to go to the child support agency directly, the student loan agency, you know, the Department of Education or student loan directly to straighten out if there's an error in that offset, and then deal with the Bureau of Fiscal Services. One, the agency has to tell Bureau of Fiscal Services that was an error. It's a long process and not fun, but it's not the IRS. It's already in the Bureau of Fiscal Service hands at that point.
Thanks, Nina. But I want to add one more thing about what's unique about the pandemic-related legislation is that for the economic impact payments, it was written into the law, depending on which one, because it did vary from one economic impact payment to another, some of the specifics, but we could not garnish those payments. They could not be offset. And as a matter of fact, we changed our processes. A taxpayer receiving an electronic or ACH payment, it's actually flagged different on their bank account. It is identified as an economic impact payment, or it is identified as an advanced child tax credit, because that does multiple things. One, it notifies the taxpayer when they look at their bank account that that's what the payment was for or the refund was for. But it also alerts the financial industries and people along the way to treat it according to the law, whether it could be garnished or not garnished, and how protected is that particular money from those processes. So that has been a very interesting component that we've been doing to both prepare taxpayers and industry for these particular payments because they are special and they're treated as special.
So one of the questions maybe, and this might lead to our, you know, our next slide, what are you supposed to do? We had a question from Julie Kirksick saying that she'd heard from many taxpayers that they received notices from the IRS that they would receive the advanced CTC, but they did not get the payment. So I'm wondering, you know, that could maybe be that the service has an account on file that's not their most recent account. It could be that, you know, do you have any thoughts about that? What that?
I'll start, but Ish might want to supplement. And it kind of leads to the conversations around what we're having today, especially around identity theft. If we have an open identity theft case, we don't want to make a payment to an advanced child tax credit until we have it settled on who and what return the payment needs to be determined, the eligibility needs to be determined. Some of the other filtering processes, such as compliance, you can imagine a return that is under open audit for dependency or certain refundable credits. You know, don't want to advance those payments. There's also what we call in the IRS bypass conditions, such as taxpayers file an amended return for any reason, since that return may not be processed. So what is an amended return? Taxpayer filing a return to make a change to the original return. Unfortunately, that process has to be reviewed by a tax examiner or a customer service representative. And so until that return is processed and fully considered to determine the impact on eligibility, if there's an impact to eligibility, those payments are paused.
So would the letter have come out? This might have been the general letter saying you look like you're eligible for the advanced CTC based on your 2020 or your 2019 return. That would have been sent out. But then when the actual payments are going out, you'd be looking at bypass conditions, whether there's an identity theft issue with it or something like that, that might prevent the payment from being issued. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, but Ish, do you want to provide any more information?
Sure. The one interesting aspect of the advanced child tax credit is there's been a lot of interest for outreach. And so IRS has been doing a lot of different types of outreach, including multiple letters, right? And the way we use them, I would view the letters as a snapshot in time. So Nina, as you mentioned, when we generated that mailing list, I think the first round of letters was back in late April when we were starting to develop and generate the list. We were taking a snapshot of what the accounts look like, where we were in the processing at the time. So, and then, you know, our vendors and our process then had 4 to 6 weeks in which they would send out the letter. So as you can see, when you take a snapshot, things would have developed over a month and a half by the time that the letters have gone out. And so there have been multiple letters, the outreach letter, which is the 6416, and then the payment letter, which was the 6417, that preceded the first July payment issuance. So, and then we also have plans for other letters as well. Yep, sorry.
Yeah, so for that, like if you have a question and this sort of leads to, well, what do you do? You know, so would somebody, if they thought that they should be getting it, do they call the IRS? Can they check through the, if they can get through to the update portal and do ID.me, will they see something that's showing what's going on with the return, or will they need to call the IRS?
So as you mentioned, there would be two channels, one of which would be the Child Tax Update Portal or CTC app, where there is a screen, your first screen, after you go through ID.me and authenticate and create a CTC up account, it will indicate whether you're eligible, pending, or ineligible. And so that's one way to confirm. And this would be based on the information we have in our systems and the way we determined and calculated the eligibility of a taxpayer and the tax year 21 amount. The other channel, of course, is, and you heard Rob mention that there are taxpayers who may not be able to access the child tax update portal would be through the phone. And there was a CTC dedicated line in the letters that were posted in the letters themselves at the top right hand corner.
So my understanding is that CTC dedicated line is staffed by contractors. And just to go to everybody's emphasis on privacy information, they can't see taxpayer count data. Is that correct? So what would happen there?
So it's a multi-step process, correct? First, the initial experience of a caller would be through that vendor. The vendors are provided job aids and all sorts of different frequently asked questions. And the intent behind that was to address those questions first. If there are questions that folks either did not look up in the FAQ page on irs.gov because they didn't have access to online, they will get that kind of information. So as you mentioned and highlighted, the contractors cannot discuss specific taxpayer account information. However, if the call goes to that point, where they're starting to ask about their specific account, the contractors will then refer them to our customer service representatives.
Okay. Now, we had a question from Melanie Melherb, and this sort of goes to maybe our next slide about what do you do if you've got a problem. She said, you know, what do you do in this situation? IRS will catch an error regarding the EIP recovery rebate credit amount claims due to a claim by someone else who first filed claiming the dependent. So that's going to be one of your dupe claim situations. What should the custodial parent do? I know if they know about the completing claim, but you know, what do they do? Do they reclaim the recovery rebate on their return? It may not be fraudulent. It's just that, you know, maybe that person claimed, was used to claiming that child and continued. So, the original claim. So maybe Denise, you might want to talk a little bit about issue resolution and including if you're, and then that goes to our slides for identity theft filters and non-identity theft fraud.
Well, for the issues regarding dependency and the civil matters between parents or other family competing to claim the dependent, I'm going to defer to Ish on that. How do you?
Is he there?
Yes, I am. So I apologize. I thought we were talking about the recovery rebate. So this is in context of the child tax credit. Is that?
Yeah, we could say that, but it's the same issue that there's a competing, you know, they're competing claims for the dependent, basically. Mm-hmm. And the first return has gotten it or claimed it, and now the second return is being stopped. So we know that's a rejection. So what does the taxpayer do? They file a paper return. What happens to that paper return?
So you have one that has a filed return that's been accepted, and I think the nomenclature or terminology we're using is posted, right? And then you have one that's filed but is waiting to be processed right now.
Both of them are claiming the child.
Right. So as I mentioned at the top, we estimate the annual amount based on what we have in our system that is posted. So once the other return comes in, and depending on whether it's the same year tax return or if it's a prior, like a tax year 19 return, that's when we also look at, is this now a duplicate dependent situation, right? Because you now have a dependent on two returns, And at that point, that is all the agency knows, right? We haven't done any sort of correspondence audit or any follow up with those taxpayers about which of them meets the requirements to claim that dependent. And I also think there was also a question around agreements. Was that also?
Right. And I think the issue is that, there had been an agreement that because the child tax, maybe the taxpayer, the custodial parent did not have enough income or any income, and so didn't get a refundable child tax credit or an earned income credit. So there was no need to file a return, but now there is a need. And so, in the past, she allowed the non-custodial parent to claim the child. But in fact, it's the custodial parent that's actually the one eligible under the law. So if the taxpayer files the paper return, will it get sent to, it will be reviewed and then sent to audit, or what will happen there? And then the taxpayer has the ability to show that they're the custodial parent, or what?
So recall that these are monthly payments that we're generating, right? So at this point, I don't believe there's any sort of compliance treatment or anything that would say we as an agency would then review this and do some. I think there are, and I know at the top you mentioned you would comment.
So we can look forward that the taxpayer basically for the child tax credit, they would sort of be out of luck. And then file at the end of the year, and claim it on their return for that year, knowing that it will get stopped and they will need to produce some documentation during that process?
Yes, the reconciliation would happen at that tax year 21 filing.
And for the economic impact payment and the rebate recovery credit, if the custodial parent on her 2021 return wanted to claim the rebate recovery credit for that child, but it had already been paid out to the non-custodial parent, what would happen there? That's actually happening now, I think, right? So, it's already been the economic impact payments or the rebate recovery credit for that child have already been paid out to the non-custodial parent. And the custodial parent is coming in on the 2021 return saying, wait, pay it to me. And the IRS is saying, we already paid out the economic impact payment for that child, for that social security number. What does the custodial parent, what is the custodial parent able to do? Would they get a rejection notice or a notice of deficiency or what? It would be math error, right?
That's where it would start as math error.
Okay. So it would start as a math error. And that goes back to that point where you're going to get, if there's a math error, you're going to get that notice that says we've adjusted your account and disallowed the rebate recovery credit for this child. You have 60 days to come in and dispute that. And then we'll go through the normal review process and you can submit information showing that this child was yours. And then it's not clear what would happen. And the math error would be the person who files second, correct? Because the payment has already been made out to the first person. In this scenario, the non-custodial filed first and got the rebate recovery credit or the economic impact payment. The custodial filed second. Is that clear as mud?
I think we could have a whole class on economic.
Well, yeah, we're actually talking about doing a whole series of working through the roadmap at a high level, but still trying to emphasize to people the really important steps that even though they're not tax lawyers, they need to know in order to be able to help the people that they're working with, in the community to understand where they are in this process. So, you know, to go on a little bit, and people are doing a great job asking questions. We have 7 minutes. I don't know whether people are fine asking questions about want to weigh in here, or we want to just continue about what you need to do if you're selected for identity theft or non-identity theft.
I could cover this pretty quickly.
Okay.
I think part of it is just to have a complete and accurate return. It's just make sure that, you know, one, the preparation process includes gathering all the information necessary to file the return, whether it's e-file, paper, or even a streamlined return through the non-file portal. That really kind of protects a lot of these processes. Now, for identity theft, you know, we have pretty robust identity theft filters based on patterns of fraud, also taking a look at historical information regarding the filing of patterns for that individual. Also, you know, other information that we may have on that taxpayer, such as, you know, we know that the taxpayers receiving W-2 information, and none of that information is included on the return. And it just causes us to, maybe we want to look at this taxpayer. For the identity theft process, we do issue notice to the taxpayer. We do ask the taxpayer to authenticate themselves and verify that they filed a return. The no response is that if we get no response at all from the taxpayer, then we will just not process the return or release the refund. So for a taxpayer to authenticate, you know, the taxpayer can go online to ID Verify, and a segue from what Rob was saying is that is an interactive questionnaire about the return, where it will ask specific questions that are likely known only to the taxpayer, and will actually authenticate them and that they file that return. And then if that process is successful, we will release that refund. The taxpayer can call and interact with a customer service representative trained on the Taxpayer Protection Program authentication process. They will interview the taxpayer and release that refund. If a taxpayer fails that process, and some taxpayers will, because they may be unbanked or underserved, and some of the, or they may even be a first-time filer that may have trouble, they can actually set up an appointment with the Taxpayer Assistance Center and be authenticated, and we can go ahead and process their return and release the refund. As last resort, we can work identity theft, taxpayer protection program through correspondence. It's not optimal because if you think about it, the pandemic did shutter some of the response and delivery of mail to the IRS. We do have to consume that information, control it, assign it to someone, and then have that mail evaluated. So it may take 30 to 60 days for us to take a look and make a decision on the identity theft, but we will work through correspondence. We do recognize that there's been, you know, some challenges with taxpayers getting through on some of the services. These are some things to look forward to. As Rob was talking about, that we're changing our authentication process to use our online tools. In mid-November, that it will provide a different mechanism where taxpayers can provide credentials such as a driver's license, a passport, take a picture, and answer the questions that we need for ID Verify. So that will change from like a financial quiz to a more interactive authentication process that comes out in May. And also along the way, we are always evaluating our filters and evaluating the cases in our queue. And if we have additional third-party information, And that could even actually be the filing of a W-2, could also be information we have with the Bureau of Fiscal Service regarding banking information, that we may release those refunds without further contact with the taxpayer, and they just get their refund. So we do handle that, identity theft in that way. And then for our non-identity theft filters, some of these will be paused because we can't verify the withholding or the wages claimed on the return that is the basis for a refundable credit or even a refund with overstated withholding. And then we have a process, what we call systemic verification. And this goes to the discussion we had earlier, where the IRS is always consuming the newest, latest and greatest information from W-2s from the Social Security Administration. We are also, the IRS is processing other information returns here at the IRS, and that information is being made available. And we utilize that in our screening processes. And once we get a match and everything looks good, those refunds are released on a daily basis, and we will not further hold that refund from any further delay. And so that is the non-identity theft side of that particular work. If we really want to have more conversation with the taxpayer from a compliance perspective, that's where we have what we start out as with wages and withholding, which is the initiation of a claim disallowance process, or we'll initiate a process of automated questionable credit where the taxpayer will receive a proposed adjustment to remove the income or remove the withholding. And if we cannot get it settled, we can issue a statutory notice of deficiency, which will give them their rights, or start the claim disallowance process, you know, to what we call recapture withholding credit, and then pay the taxpayer the net of the refund that is due to them. So Nina?
That's great. I think we've really covered an enormous amount. I know that for everyone, the questions, there are as many questions as we've answered, but I hope this system has helped, this discussion has at least showed the process by which returns go through and why there may be so many issues with processing a return for the taxpayers that we're particularly concerned about, for the lower income, no income population, particularly those taxpayers who have not been part of the IRS filing system and I've entered through the non-filer portal, as we had made clear at the very beginning, the returns filed through the non-filer portal or alternative systems, like the Code for America system, are returns, and they are going to fall, process through these things, these steps, and could be tripped up at any point along the way. We are going to have our next workshop on Monday, the 27th, and that will be, now that we have a sense of what the filing system is, we're going to look at the population that is going to be pulled or is being pulled into this system and looking at their characteristics and trying to get a better understanding of what they can navigate and what they can't navigate and what needs of assistance what kind of assistance needs they have based on their characteristics. So we're trying to use the workshops to build an understanding both of the IRS systems, but also the population that social programs are trying to reach through the IRS. And then what are some of the things that we need to think about going forward as we design systems or try to improve the social benefits delivery through the IRS going forward. So I hope to see you all on the 27th. We'll be sending out a link the week before. And thank you all for attending. And if you're interested in taxpayer rights on a broader level, we have some international tax conferences on taxpayer rights coming up, and hope to see you there too. Okay, thank you all. And thank you, Denise. Thank you, Ish. And thank you, Rob, for doing this. And I hope all of you have a good day.